So I'm Joan Steitz. I've been a professor at Yale since late 1970, so a very, very long time. I'm in the Department of Molecular Biophysics and Biochemistry, and the wonderful thing about our department is that it's both a medical school department and an arts and sciences department, and therefore we're responsible for an undergraduate major, so there are lots of fabulous undergraduates that we teach, and we also have a graduate program that's a very good graduate program, and in addition, members of my department teach biochemistry to the medical students. So we're also divided in being part of the department is at the medical school and part of the department is in what's called Science Hill, and that also means that we have interactions both with the other basic sciences and with a lot of people that are actually in the medical school. So it's a very rich environment, and what holds our department together is that everybody's interested in the molecular basis of life. In other words, figuring out how the molecules really are contributing to all the things that make a cell a living cell. And so that's what we're up to, and I've been really fortunate to have wonderful people in my lab, and here I'm surrounded by some of the postdocs and graduate students who are currently in the lab.
So my name is Jessica Brown. I'm a fifth-year postdoc in Joan's lab, and how I became interested in science is as an undergraduate. My mom told me that I needed to graduate with honors. And so I was a third year student at the time, so there was only one option left for me to graduate with honors, and that was to do a departmental honors project. And that required going into a lab, finding an advisor, and coming up with a project. And so it was completely new to me, and I was very lucky to have a wonderful mentor who took me under his wings and showed me how to pipette, because I didn't know what even pipettes were. And yeah, just really showed me the entire scientific process.
So my name is Anna Dilberg. I'm also a postdoc with Joan since 4 years now. And I guess I got interested in a career in science actually back in high school. I specifically remember asking a question to a biology teacher, and she didn't know the answer, and she just said, "Why don't you find it out?" And that kind of stuck with me, and I was like, "Yeah, why don't I?" And I don't even remember that question, so I don't think I've figured out that specific answer, but it got me interested in thinking about that you could actually do that for a living, figure things out as a career, and that was very exciting, I thought. So then from there I kind of directed myself towards the research-oriented undergraduate and graduate work.
Hi, my name is Paulina Papica, and I'm actually from Poland, where I did my master's, and then I did my PhD in Canada, and now I'm here in Joan's lab as a postdoc. I think that I've been always interested in science. I used to like mathematics, and when I was finishing high school, I had a question. I asked myself the question whether I want to study mathematics or biological sciences. And it happened like this that I was accepted to this great program, and I started to study viruses. And I was so fascinated, like how these organisms that have very, very small genome can change the whole cell life cycle of the cell. And so I just stayed studying viruses, and here I also study viruses.
Okay, so my name is Tanea Mallory. I'm a fourth year graduate student in Joan's lab. I knew that I wanted to be in the sciences from the beginning. Having taken biology and chemistry in high school, I knew that I was interested in biochemistry. And so I pursued a degree in biochemistry at Mount Holyoke College as my undergraduate degree, and then you know, my interest was still there, still present, and I went on to get my PhD so I could become a scientist. And as a graduate student, I learned how to critically think about science and to learn about the scientific process, and that's what I'm here in Joan's lab doing.
We come into lab and we have some experiment ongoing, so we have test tubes with, you know, different samples in them, and we do different things to them too. In Joan's lab, we study RNA, so we probably try to extract the RNA from cells that we grow in the lab, and then we try to look at levels of RNA or behavior of the RNA in different ways. Yeah, we probably grow some cells to get some more RNA, pretty much. So we can do it all over again.
Mm-hmm.
But you don't do only that every day.
No, definitely. And we also have, I mean, think about science, we'll read papers, we'll think about, you know, how to move our projects ahead. We'll have discussions with each other and with Joan, where we talk about what we did in recent days.
I feel like that's the most exciting part, right? When you have the data and you know that something cool is going on, and you go talk to your colleague, others in the lab or outside the lab, and you come up with a really cool conclusion or, you know, a hypothesis, then you can do more testing, more experiments to see if that works. I feel like that's what keeps me going, is that sort of, you know, exciting moments in science.
I'd say, if you think about our projects and we talk to other people in the lab, we have ideas, we discuss them with Joan, Joan has ideas, you know, we present our work at seminars in the department, and other people will have give us input, so it's kind of really many inputs.
Yeah, I think what is important is the collaborative part, because everybody has a little bit different expertise, and of course scientists cannot know everything, so when a lot of people come together to get an idea, this is, I think, the best way to do it.
Let me sort of underscore that. So I firmly believe that everybody should have had their own project. So nobody in my lab is sort of part of a quote team that's heading for a particular goal. But everybody's working on some aspect of how RNA molecules work in a cell. And since they're so very important, they do all sorts of things, so there are all sorts of possibilities. But I also feel that, as you heard from them, that the way people get ideas is by talking to other people. So we actually have organized subgroups within the lab where smaller groups of people come together and actually talk about what they did in the last week and what worked and what didn't work, and try to get ideas from the other people that are there about what you could try that might make it work. Because no one person, so the image that I want to give is that science is not a singular activity. It's very much a social and collaborative activity in terms of the excitement of the ideas and what you're trying to figure out.
But for me, when I was in graduate school, it was a hard choice whether I wanted to go be Mother Teresa or if I wanted to stay in science. And I remember telling my parents that I wanted to quit. And they told me, no, you're too talented, don't do that. So as an alternative, my friend was in the Peace Corps at the time, and she was serving in Malawi. So I went to Africa for 3 weeks, and I was with her. And so she was there at a place in an HIV clinic. And so I met an individual there, and he was also around my age, and I found out that he was responsible for bringing the antiretrovirals to Malawi. And this, he brought it there in 2004, and I was there in 2008. Made me feel quite small with what I had done so far in the world, considering that he had brought these drugs that could potentially save lives. But anyways, I remember getting the little packaging slip to see what drugs they were. And all of them were very basic antiretroviral drugs, some of which that had been approved in the U.S. I think back in 1988, and it was 2004 until these people had access. And so it was powerful to go to this HIV clinic. There was just people everywhere that they walked for miles and miles. I don't know if they did, it was a day's journey's worth to get to this rare clinic. And just to watch them stand in line, and they were so happy to be there.
So. More scientific knowledge contributes in all sorts of ways to society. And I mean, look at what technology has done to our daily lives. And if you don't have any understanding of what these forces are and of the scientific process itself and what's possible, and it would be very, very difficult, I think. And so I'm a firm believer in that. You know, science is a good goal just in itself because of the many ways it contributes. And certainly what's happened in the last half century in terms of the contribution of biology to medicine. You know, it's just absolutely incredible that we have the diagnostics we have and some of the therapeutics that we have that have come directly out of doing the basic science. And also, I mean, that we have this multi-billion dollar biotech industry. I mean, that there used to be a pharmaceutical industry, but we didn't have biotech industry where people were actually, you know, doing the very early stages of discovery that then is leading to products not just for medicine, but for agriculture and all forensics, all sorts of other things. So it's just absolutely remarkable how much science really does contribute.
Why not? We are exactly the same. We have the same capabilities as men, so yeah.
Yeah, it's a fun and exciting job. I mean, the 90% gets you down, but the 10% is really great. And so of course we should do it. It's fun.
And mostly, you know, things I've sort of observed and things that I've learned from reading studies that have been done on this, and you know, it really turns out that there are data out there that says that more diverse groups of people come up with more creative solutions to problems. And so having women is one of the ways of diversifying the scientific workforce. And I really think that, you know, people do, because of their past experience, bring different solutions to different problems. And so I think having women around really, really does increment the scientific enterprise in a wonderful way.
I have it in more subtle ways with body language, like not making eye contact with me, but if there were men in the room, they were talking to them.
Well, during my conferences, I experienced like more subtle things, as Jessica said, like that maybe somebody was extra nice to me, a little bit sleazy because I was a girl. You know, not really looking at the quality of my data, but me as a woman, which is not very nice.
Yeah. I think in instances like that, it's important to be professional, be above it. So, you know, you run into them, they do happen, but what's important is that then you're just like, I'm a scientist, it doesn't matter whether I'm a woman or not, right? Please just evaluate me on my way of thinking. Mm-hmm. There's nothing else that you should be evaluating this interaction.
I believe that you learn by example, and Jones is an amazing example. Her standards are incredibly high, and so you learn how to do things at the highest level.
Yeah, she said. I mean, it's very inspiring to work with Joan. I mean, and I don't think that like you often go around thinking about, oh wow, it's a woman who you know, it's just she's so brilliant, so that's what you focus on. But of course, at the end of the day, when you think about like how you want to. That you can also try to pursue your career and you shouldn't be held back. And it's amazing to know that you know, being a woman and being really at the top is totally doable.
For young scientists as us, it's like, I don't know, 50% or maybe more of our success is connected to our mentor. So it's very important to have a good mentor. And as you can see about like what kind of work are the postdocs from John's lab, where they now, and they are all very successful. So this say by itself, right?
So at the scientific level, of course, it's been a fantastic journey. Also the professional level, Jim has a great way of interacting with people in a nice, generous way and giving way, right? And I feel like that's also a quality that was important to learn from.
I mean, I think getting involved early in college is really important because what we do know is that a much higher fraction, for instance, at Yale, people who come in to Yale as freshmen say they want to do science than actually end up graduating in science. And I think that part of what happens is they get into these huge classes right at the beginning and they get sort of turned off because it's impersonal, whereas if we could get more people into the lab right at the beginning, that we would probably have a higher survival rate in science, because that gives the personal contact and makes people feel like what they're doing is important, and not that they're just one face in a big, you know, lecture hall learning about general chemistry.
I would say that it's a universal thing, is to work hard. It always takes a lot of work, and to know that you have some sort of talent in this field, I think those two things, and to always surround yourself with the best people. That if, just like when you're playing sports, basketball, soccer, whatever your interest is, that if you play with the best people, you eventually become better at what you do.
Also keeping keeping curiosity, because science is a lot about figuring out new things, so there aren't any answers. That's like why, that's why it's so exciting and interesting. So to try to, you know, learn a lot and then try to use it and keep an open mind to see that even though you have learned that things are in a certain way, that isn't necessarily always true. So kind of keeping an open mind and, you know, keeping curious.
I would say that it's important not to give up. Because science seems to be very exciting, but actually like 90% of the results that we get are negative, or like 90% of things don't work, and there's this 10% that is like, wow, it's amazing. So it's just like, keep going and don't give up.
My suggestion would be to have experience. So when I was in high school, I shadowed a forensic scientist for a day. I also interned at the environmental department of my, you know, the state, and that was a great experience because I knew that then that I liked molecular work. I didn't like environmental. I didn't like forensic science, and so getting that experience helped me. And also taking those AP courses, it gives you a head, you know, a head start when you go to college. You already know what it's like to take kind of that level of course and difficulty, and so when you get to college, you're better off.
Even though you do one research experience and you might not like it, but you're still interested in science, definitely continue to explore, because there's just so many different areas of research out there. We're at a very basic level of research, and maybe like the clinical and more translational medicine is interesting to people.
But I think two really important things have been said here. One is to always put yourself in the most challenging environment that you think you can survive, because that's where you're going to learn the most and make the biggest strides forward. And the other thing is about not giving up. And that's one of the hardest things in science from a long-term perspective, is to decide when you're trying to do something that's just so far ahead of its time that there's no way that you're going to get there and you should give up, as opposed to if you just make one last push and try it a little bit differently, that's going to get you the answer. And I don't have a magic solution to that problem, but figuring that out is something that's very, very challenging for all scientists.